So I'm John Drake. I work at PlayStation. I'm the director of portfolio strategy at Sony Computer Entertainment America, part of the team that's helping put on PlayStation Experience. Thank you for coming to the show. It's our first year, and we're really psyched to have you guys here.
You've done a great job, John Drake.
Oh, thanks, Johnny.
So John Drake and I talked on Monday while I was in a taxi cab to an undisclosed location.
Yes.
And you were talking about how stressed you were about putting on this entire thing.
Well, both of us were in cars. I was driving in traffic to work.
You were so upset, too. It was like, San Francisco, the traffic is so bad today because it's raining, and no one can drive when it's raining. That did happen. And yes. I was like, it's raining in L.A. too, man.
There's a light drizzle.
Yeah,
the drought's chaos over.
Right? Yeah. I'm not going to work today.
People just spinning in circles like roundabout by Dan Teasdale.
Yeah. Mario Kart style.
So we had that conversation, but then we got here and the vibe has been really great. People have been really awesome. And your booth is crazy down the floor. If you guys haven't seen the Infinity booth yet, go check it out. Take a superhero selfie and have a good time down there.
I didn't do that at E3. We had that at E3.
The line was too long. It was
wildly
crazy.
Popular. Yeah. Right. I was like, can I get in there? They're like, who are you?
Who are you? Get out of here.
The line starts over there, sir.
I love... Okay. I also love the Mark Suits displays of the Iron Man as if it's like Tony Stark's lab. There's like...
Yeah.
They're putting the Infinity art style. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's fun.
So let's introduce who we are because there's a lot to go through, Johnny.
Yes.
And where's you have guys the other mic? Microphone.
I feel like I'm just talking.
Really?
You guys have to talk too.
Why would you think that?
Here, so, Kelly, you can take it away from me.
So let's go down the row. So I'm John. I work at PlayStation. Everyone else here actually works on this game. But let's start down there and work our way back. Who are you? Tell people who you are and what you do on the game.
Okay, so my name is Brian Leffler.
Yeah!
Woo! Thank you, John. Thank you. I'm part of the story department.
Yeah.
I run the story department there and work with cinematics and integrated into all that stuff.
Very cool.
So.
Yeah!
Hi, everyone. My name is Thomas Estrada. I'm the lead animator in charge of cinematics. Do animation.
Yeah. It's an important thing, animation.
My name's John. I work on the Disney Infinity project.
On Disney Infinity.
Disney shouldn't have had that Bloody Mary. I work on the Disney Infinity project with this incredibly talented group of gentlemen.
John Vignacchi is the T for Teen member of the panel. Everyone else is E10 plus, yeah.
My name is Kelly Murphy. It says on this slide that I'm lead designer Disney Infinity game design, which is way better than really what I do. I work, so I'll take that. I work on characters mainly, the enemies and the avatars you play as.
Very
and
cool.
Try and help out, figure out what they do.
Awesome. OK. I'm John Diesta. I'm the lead character designer and the character art director for Disney Infinity. Okay. I draw a lot.
He's the master doodler. Yeah. So we're going to pound through this really quickly. I'm guessing, has everyone here played Disney Infinity before? Everyone is aware of what it is. For people at home who might be watching the stream, let's give the quick summary of how Disney Infinity came to be. Because actually, it's a really interesting story. It's not just, hey, this game you know and love, but it came from a previous game that you guys worked on. Sort of was the genesis of it. Do you want to tell people where this sprung from?
In the beginning, there was a video game company called Avalanche Software that was working very, very closely with Pixar and very, very closely with the Walt Disney Company on a game called Toy Story 3. And so basically, what we were trying to do at Disney Interactive is come up with like distinct ways that we could, through gameplay, achieve the same kind of thing that happens when you visit one of our parks or you're on one of our cruise ships or you go to see one of our films. We wanted to create Disney memories. And so over time, when we started doing this, we worked super closely with everyone across the Walt Disney Company. This actually ended up becoming a pretty huge endeavor for us. I mean, we started in 2010, right after Toy Story 3 was done, and there was another team at Avalanche working on Cars 2. And that's when we began collaborating with a whole bunch of different people from around all the different divisions and all the different filmmakers that had contributed to Disney's legacy about creating not just a video game, but what we would call a software platform. The idea being that, you know, over time, players could go pick up more figures and pick up more play sets and expand their experience, while at the same time, it's really difficult to kind of predict how big a film's going to be or how successful a film will be. And so it allowed us internally to actually be able to create individual figures or create full-on play sets, which you guys know is like the largest level of support that we can do for a particular property. So it kind of became a win for the company and then a win for consumers as well. And so I'm just kind of going to flip through this. That was John Lasseter with John Blackburn and Jeff Bunker, one of our early meetings that we had. And this piece of concept art is actually the one that we had shown Pixar as an example of what these characters would look like in toy form. So the concept was that these weren't going to be the characters themselves, but rather toy versions of those characters. And that then allowed us to have the creative freedom of actually bringing these characters together. But John Lasseter had asked for an example of, you know, what does that look like? Because filmmakers traditionally hate that.
Yeah.
The idea of, you know, a character like Buzz Lightyear being inside of Pirates of the Caribbean doesn't make sense to the original content
it's
creator.
It's a huge disconnect, right? They've worked hard to define that style and how
exactly,
it looks and feels. They
exactly.
don't want to make it blend.
And so, and they don't want to feel cheap, like someone just mashes all the characters up. So we had to come up with this creative conceit that, you know, these were toy versions of the characters, not the characters actually themselves. And this was a piece of art. I mean, Diesta, maybe you want to talk about this one a little bit in terms of concept and how this came together.
Sure. Around this, when this concept was first sketched up, we were still trying to figure out the overall style, and we were trying to figure out like how to wrap everything together, because at the time we were very inspired by the urban vinyl figures, and so that was kind of our way to create like a toy designed collectible figure, and that was still like, what does that mean, you know? And
yeah.
So after we started figuring out like how to get those big, bold shapes that's still simple. Like, we just started trying to put all the characters in a lineup to show how exciting it could be.
I remember a version of this that had Jasmine driving a car with Hulk in it and Jack Sparrow riding in a medical helicopter shooting a goo gun at Rex.
Super ambitious opening concept doc.
Exactly.
Here's
right?
a 5-year plan in one slide.
this piece of art that you guys are seeing right now meant so much to us, and it's hung up all around the studio because this is the one where John and the different creative directors at Pixar said, okay, we actually can see your guys' vision for how this can work, and we're behind it.
Well, and the interesting thing is, you mentioned the toy box in Toy Story 3, but that game was not, you know, what we think of when you think of a movie game in sort of the world of, especially kids and family movies, often it's a pretty unambitious project. It's sort of a retelling what happens, maybe some little side content.
Right.
But Toy Story 3 was actually almost like crazily ambitious. Johnny and I have often had conversations about like the scope of the games that Avalanche makes, where I'm like, how many things are you trying to cram in to this game that's going to also sell really well just because it has a really awesome Disney, you know, movie attached to it? But the toy box in Toy Story 3 was this mode where you could actually create and play and sort of interact with the characters in almost like an open context that wasn't just a linear narrative you were playing through.
Yeah, I mean, for Avalanche, that was a huge moment in their development because although they were an internally owned studio at the time, there were external studios that wanted the license to make Toy Story 3 the video game. And Avalanche was bidding against them. Our own internal studio was bidding against external developers. And, you know, although they had pitches that creatively were great, they were, you know, see the film, play the game. And Avalanche had said, you know, we have this vision where we're going to have that, you know, moments from the film, of course, that you can play. But
right.
we love this idea of this toy box mode where you can create and build and customize.
That's what the world of toys is really about. It's about playing and interacting with things. It's not just about having, you know, this having the same experience over and over. And that's what movies are for. Right?
Yeah,
but
right.
Games that are interactive.
Yeah. And so the guys at Avalanche pitched their vision for what the Toy Story 3 video game would ultimately become. And Pixar said, that's the idea that we like,
cool.
despite, you know, great offers from other external companies.
Right. Just one other thing. Yeah. And the other thing that I remember is we had approached Lasseter and we said, well, we have these two variations of gameplay. There's the open sandbox version or there's the movie version. So which one would you like? And he's like, I'll have one of each. And so at
true.
That point, we're like, oh, okay. So that became the pitch that we... I think that we won.
I mean, that's you're absolutely right, Brian. And then I remember that, yeah, it was like making two games in one.
Yeah. And that was a challenge. So.
Yeah. Well,
Well, and so, and from there, you know, the tech team and all the stuff, that all the people who had worked at Avalanche on Toy Story 3, Infinity was born, and in the first round of Infinity, do you call it version 1.0? You don't. It was just Disney Infinity.
You know what's funny about the whole, like, 2.0? That was, the way that that all came up actually was all internal conversation.
Okay.
At that point, the marketing team hadn't figured out what they wanted to call it.
Sure.
And so the big thing was, like, everyone kept on saying, like, what are we doing 2.0, 2.0, 2.0? And, like, it kept on coming out, and then it just stuck.
2.0.
I know. It drives me crazy because it could be called something else, or just called Disney Infinity because that's what it is.
And because it's a platform, right? Like, all these, we'll talk about how things play together. But so we have on screen some of the characters you guys had in the first iteration, first year of the game. I mean, you have the Incredibles, Cars, and then year two, Infinity parentheses 2.0 edition, you have Marvel superheroes. And we can talk about how it works, right? So you have the playsets and the toy box, but look at, I mean, it's
amazing.
So for
those of you that don't know how a Toys to Life product works.
Yeah, talk about Toys to Life, Johnny.
Right.
So do toys come to life in the video game?
So basically, you have these figures, you put the figures down on what we call the Infinity Base. It's not a portal. No, there's no hate in there.
Just, I didn't say that.
It's called the Infinity Base.
I don't know who you're talking
about. And then the characters come alive inside of the game, and then you can play as them. So that's how that's how it works. So this year we integrated three big brands from Marvel, Avengers, Spider-Man, as well as Guardians of the Galaxy. And so working with these guys has been great. And then that's one side of the software, the play sets. The other side, of course, is the toy box mode, which I think this year we put a lot of effort into from a development perspective. So the toy box mode, for those of you that might be watching this and don't know, that's where you can actually take the Marvel and the Disney characters, mash them up, tell your own stories.
Crazy things happen.
Yeah.
Crazy things happen in Toy Box.
Our marketing team was bringing in families that are fans of Infinity to do testimonials of, like, how much fun they have playing the game together. And one of the commercial, I think it's going to be a commercial if it's not out already, is this dad going, I didn't know how badly I wanted Hulk to beat up Donald Duck, but I really did.
I mean, Spider-Man is literally riding Aladdin's carpet in the thing that's on screen right now. Like, what is going on? Well, can you imagine that world where he's helping him fight in the Marvel Universe?
Well, the thing is, like, this is how we played with toys growing up, right? Yeah. I mean, that was the entire thing. It was like, so when we would go around the company and explain this to people, they'd be like, and so what happens in this toy box mode? It's like, just think of it like your parents' living room floor. You dump out all your toys, you play with them the way you want to. And everyone instantly got that.
Yeah.
And that's where we were able then to, you know, really push this forward in terms of what we could do creatively and what the vision was. Actually, the toy box mode, of course, inspired by Toy Story 3, but we were originally doing multiplayer testing.
Yeah.
And we had we didn't want to do like a standard lobby. Right, so we had a ready up room, and you could kind of just, you know, dink around and, you know, like, put out little toys and stuff. But we started noticing that during our play test, kids were spending more time in that room where they could actually go around and kind of play how they wanted to than they were inside of the play sets that we had designed.
Right.
And that's when we were like, okay, we're totally onto something here. Maybe people just want to explore. And it's like Blackburn always says, there's only been a couple of times in my career that I've known that we had lightning in a bottle. And when I was watching those guys play through this play test and inside of the toy box mode and listening to the kids laugh and listening to them shout and scream at each other, you know, all in fun, that, you know, we had something really special.
Well, and you look at where games have gone for that group, you know, with games like Minecraft, games like Disney Infinity, the ability to go build and create is a big part of why people come to games with IP that they know or, you know, IP that they don't, and they spend more and more time and invest more and more time, right? You don't play it and then put it on the shelf and you're done. This is like a living world that you've built. So we can talk a little bit maybe more about how you develop the characters and figures. I don't work at Disney. I wish. because it's a really cool challenge to have these known properties, right? You're not creating characters from scratch, but you have to interpret them and put them into the world. So we can talk a little bit about, man, Nick Fury looks awesome.
John Diesta.
Yes, John Diesta. Why don't you tell us about your process?
Here, take the microphone.
Here. All right. Hey, great panel, bro. Do we have any more microphones?
I don't know.
Okay.
I can steal one of
here.
Guys, or we can just
we're gonna have a chat. Yeah, thank God you took Johnny's microphone away. Now he can't interrupt us anymore.
I was gonna say next to you so we can talk too.
Oh, man. So you guys look at all, I mean, Disney obviously has a lot of things coming out, a lot of movies in development, a lot of big properties for families and mass market. How do you go from looking at what is coming out in the Disney pipeline and then turning that into a toy, turning that into a character?
So I can talk about the turning into the toy part.
Sure.
But as far as the discussion.
That's the John Vignacchi business guess.
Yeah. That's you, Jamie.
Best guess. Look at these great things on screen, Johnny. How do you pick which ones you make into Disney Infinity?
How do we pick them, guys? I think that that's a funny...
No one will answer this question.
We should all contribute here.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, there's an opportunity when, you know, you've got a big tentpole release coming from the company, so that factors into why we make the decisions. Hey, thanks, man. Yeah, you totally roll.
Yeah. Best crew in the business.
So obviously that's a key decision.
I mean, I know from, at least from the story perspective, like we're always down in our room and we're just like, we're doing everything we possibly can to get the characters that we want, but
right.
But there's other factors that go into it, and Disney is a huge, huge company with lots of opportunities. So we try and, I mean, at least I know from my perspective, I think we try and get the characters that we love, that we feel need to come out, and also try and obtain a balance in some form of characters versus new characters.
Yeah, and you can see that in the Marvel stuff. Like, there are obvious big characters. There's the Avengers, there's Guardians, who, you know, there were big releases this year in those franchises. But then there's kind of fan favorites inside that catalog that aren't hero releases that are coming out in films that I guess you guys go and kind of fight for, right? You want Iron Fist, you want something like that.
Kelly, I was just going to say, when we first started out, it was like, can we have this character?
Right, please.
And now it's, hey, we want this character
nice.
In there. So I think they're becoming more
big time.
But it's great, though. I mean, yeah. it shows what the product has turned out to be and what it means to a very massive group of kids and families out there. So I think it's important.
So do we want to talk about, going from sketches to models and things. I mean, this is, you know, in the style of the art that we have here, right? Do you want to talk about how we go from the original art style up top to the sort of Disney Infinity-fied style below? How you interpret these characters?
So this is at the very early stages of Disney Infinity, where we're trying to explain the differences between like the actual film version and the version that we're doing. Our first impression was we don't want to create a style that's too overbearing, where you first see the style. We don't want to create a style that's too character-driven, where they don't belong together as far as the same family or the same universe. So our impression was we want you to read character first, style second.
Okay.
So when you first see like Disney Infinity Buzz, we want you to make sure that, hey, that's Buzz. But he actually is stylistically quite a bit different than the film version.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we were trying to be inspired by the kind of vinyl-y urban feel of like collector's figures, and the same thing with like Jack. Like, he's still quite a bit more detailed than like Bob or Buzz.
Mm-hmm.
But
I love what you call him, Bob.
Oh,
right?
Oh yeah. I guess that was an early Pixar thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. Bob Parr.
Yeah, Bob Parr. All right, Mr. Incredible. Jeez.
There you go.
Okay. So,
I'm waiting for the Bob figure where he's not in costume. It's just him being an accountant at his desk all day.
It'll be a power disc.
Yeah, it'll be a great power disc.
I'm sorry, we were arguing over here.
That's fine.
So as far as like with Jack Sparrow there, he's still quite a bit different than the other two, but he's still quite a bit more simplified than the film version.
So you start with the style of the characters, and then you make models pretty much right away, right? You get into sketching making, because you have to make them 4 inches tall, right? It's not only how does it look on a big screen when you're playing with it, but how do you make this a statue that you want to
Shelby, will you go back
so
one
clearly?
Slide? I wanted the Mr. Incredible one, I think, is the one for me anyway that always is the most interesting to look at, specifically because, and John, maybe you want to talk about this a little bit, but when you actually go to make it a figure, in order for it not to fall, and then all of the things you have to consider from a manufacturing and shipping perspective, like when you actually go to physically create these, I mean, that all went into kind of developing what our style became.
Are you talking about because he has small legs and like a big upper torso? And
yeah, the tiny feet, like that figure wouldn't normally ever stand.
Right.
Yeah, that home version of Mr. Incredible definitely won't be able to stand on his own. So we definitely wanted to make sure that in our process of trying to make them more urban vinyl, like mm-hmm. they feel more substantial, especially like what you were talking about earlier, When you scale down like these, let's take the film versions. If you scale them down to 4 inches, their details get quite a bit smaller.
And right.
It almost turns out to be noise at that size.
Sure.
So we want to make the shapes a little bit bolder, like clean up the details and emphasize certain things that make them, so that when we get it down to 4 inches, we're still caring about those guys.
Right, and you can even see it on Buzz, right? I mean, you lose the name tag and just have the big red button, because the big red button pops out and stands out. You can kind of see immediately what you recognize from that character.
Totally. I think a big thing is, like, we want to make sure that that they don't start to sag, so we want to give them substantial weight on their feet, and even without the base, our goal was to try to make them stand on their own.
Yeah. And that reads, I feel like there's often, we'll talk a little more later, but there's often like almost a moment of anticipation in the pose that you've worked out, which works great for crouching or about to explode or sort of about to unleash a bow and arrow in Meredith's case, for example.
Sorry to interrupt you, John. One of the fun stories just to tell real quick about this is that it was GDC 2011, I think, when we had actually done our first character that came out and was printed. Mm-hmm. And Pixar did it for us. And so we went to Pixar, and they presented a different Mr. Incredible than that. Actually, the pose was, what was the original pose? Yeah, can you show us?
Give us a demonstration.
What was it?
He was pretty much just standing there. It was,
no, but wasn't he like, sorry. Yeah, I guess that is pretty dumb.
Pretty much that.
But it was something different. Buzz Lightyear's pose is the same, but the original figures that were like, because again, we worked in close collaboration with Pixar on this. Was it open?
Yeah.
Show me.
Yeah.
Stand up, Kelly. Kelly, just stand up and show him.
Sure.
It was like that. All right.
Great.
Thanks, bro.
There.
So, but they were originally, I mean, because so they turned out being 4 inches tall, but they were originally about this big, right? I mean, they originally, was it like 6 or 7 inches? They were huge.
The first prints were 6 or 7 inches.
Almost like collector statues, not figurines.
Yeah, they were huge.
That's ultimately what we wanted. We were like, 6 or 7 inches. But I think we went through like a little
Back and forth.
Session, because we were like, how are kids going to carry?
There was that. That was part of consideration. But right. We were working with Pixar and Disney Consumer Products, and Disney Consumer Products does a lot of action figures and things like that with great partners like Hasbro and others.
Sure. plug there. That's good.
Well,
good partner management.
You know, I know like someone's like, I don't want to hurt you. So anyway, but they came back and they were like, hey, the figures should be this big, almost like Lego minifigs. They were tiny.
That's right.
And then there was a big battle back and forth between us caught in the middle between them wanting to be like collectible statues and then something that was more economical in terms of manufacturing but way smaller. And so again, everything that John was talking about in terms of like the details and things that went into it we were like, well, why don't we just all be happy and meet in the middle? And so that's where the 4 inches
came
from.
Subtle Mickey voice you go into when you do.
Actually, you know who does a really good Mickey Mouse voice? Is you. Will you please do it? Yeah, you do.
I totally don't.
Just do it real quick.
I totally don't. Someone else left a message on your phone, and it wasn't me.
Would you do it just for a second, Leffler? So whenever we cut like cinematics, Leffler goes and does the storyboard, right? Hey, give us one. Just you do it.
It wasn't me.
Yeah, it was. Wasn't it?
No.
Doesn't he do a good Mickey Mouse?
I'm sure it's great.
I did Rex.
Okay, all right, then do Rex.
Oh man, I can't
just
remember.
Just do it.
Basically, if there's anyone who's ever needed to do like a falsetto voice or someone totally totally effeminate, they're like Leffler. Get in here. We need a voice for you. I'm like, great.
Okay, so you know, Buzz Lightyear to Star Command. Rex, can you help us on this mission?
Oh my gosh, like, I don't even know what to do. Like, help me out.
Spot on.
Wow. Yes. Glad.
Whatever.
Glad we got there.
It's so good. Do you have any other voices we can
no,
do?
No, I don't.
This has been the highlight of the panel so far.
I mean.
No, I don't.
Who's that?
I don't know. I was just getting more manly.
Oh.
So.
This is great. When we do our stand-up act later where we do impressions, our Rich Little act, it's going to be a really good round.
There was one thing that I was just going to say. This, as you guys were talking, it just reminded me, like, again, all this came back to John Lasseter in terms of trying to find the style because he wanted, like, how do you get Jack Sparrow, who's live action, to hang out with Buzz Lightyear?
Yeah.
So again, when he finally said, you know, if you can get all these characters to look like they came from the right, like the same toy line, then I'll accept it. Then they can all be in that mashup together. And that's what that's what I thought was so great and successful.
That was a
about
much
it.
More succinct way of yeah. saying everything I just tried to say for the past 20 minutes.
Well, and even here you see, like, you know, two of these five characters are 3D animated, you know, like with depth, and three of them are 2D cel shaded animated back when they were first released. And the idea of bringing live action, 2D animation, 3D animation all into one spot, like, in the abstract, doesn't seem like it would work, but you guys have really defined a style that makes that possible. And we talked a little bit about you then making them, you know, between, I'd say, 3 and 4 inch statues. And thank God you didn't make 6 or 7 inch statues, because you've already taken over an entire shelf in my house. And if they were 6 inches, I would have to, like, get a room just for infinity. And San Francisco rent's too high for that. So we see a couple different figures here. So this is sort of your raw first model at a figure, right? Like when you've gone through a bunch of iterations, you do it in sort of raw plastic.
Yeah, definitely. While we're still in development, like we want to print these out as fast as possible, get like the early prototypes going, making sure that the definition of the eyes still read at the size it's going to be. To your point, like, yeah, Phineas, he's totally 2D.
Right.
And most of these characters, we have to almost simplify and omit detail. But for like characters like Phineas and Perry, we definitely have to introduce detail because they're 2D. So, and they have to exist in a 3D space. So just by doing that, they're much closer to the Infinity family already.
Well, and so these are all characters with very iconic looks, like they appear in one form of media and they are that way. And when you talk about Marvel, there's been, over the years, different interpretations of Captain America or Iron Man, and there's cartoons and everything else. So how do you approach a character that is now defining?
Here's some hot scoops Hagen does. Awesome. Look at this.
The art style, right?
So we have a fantastic concept and character development team at Avalanche. And this is our first step. Mm-hmm. So the guy on the left, we're still applying the same things that we've learned from Infinity War. Yep. We're trying to like make things more bold and trying to exaggerate and simplify. We went a little bit too bold and maybe a little bit too simple.
He's like the biggest forearms of any character in the history of Marvel.
I will say this for our fans that might be watching this. There is a leaked piece of concept art of the original Captain America with the triangle shield.
Oh.
Do you remember
yes,
that
I
one?
Do.
Yeah.
That was
way early. Yeah, like, I don't blame me. Why would this be my fault? I'm pretty good about it. Anyway, sorry. So there's a little nugget.
Well, so you need to get the proportions right. That's sort of where you ended up going with this statue, right?
In the development of trying to figure out. So Cap was like one of our first characters that we were trying to decide like where to go with, because he's kind of in the middle, you know, of like he's not a small character. He's not Hulk sized character. So he's a good benchmark character. And we realized that, like, really quickly, that muscles are pretty much their costume, right? That's
sure.
their look. So we had to figure out a way to, like, give them anatomy without breaking the Infinity style, which is like, well, obviously, if you added muscles to Buzz, it would feel a little bit weird.
Yeah, so, if he was coming through his spacesuit with like weird rippling totally. Pecs, you'd be like, this spacesuit seems not safe for outer space travel.
Oh, yeah, totally. but so it became quickly. Very apparent that Marvel should have its own style.
Okay.
So the Infinity style should evolve to incorporate the Marvel look, but still existing in the same universe.
Right.
So Cap, that's where we ended up.
Same family, but maybe a cousin, not a brother or sister.
Yeah.
Okay, interesting. And so but Venom, almost because it's a little bit more, not supernatural, but a little bit more extreme, it's not a person who has powers, it is a sort of monster. Poses a whole bunch of different questions.
That's a symbiote, actually.
Yeah, well, okay, yes.
Not a monster.
It's being a little reductive, but yes, okay. So how do you approach a character like this where it is much more exaggerated? There's crazy sort of caricature elements to it, and keep it in the same family.
So this is kind of to your point earlier. It's like there's been plenty of interpretations of like different Marvel characters,
right?
And Venom is definitely no exception. Like he was, he's all over the place. This is a earlier concept by one of our concept guys, Jason Kim, and I love the shapes. They kind of flow into each other, and like as we all remember, like symbiotes. Well, totally getting geeky. But anyways, symbiotes are like this kind of inky, amorphous
like jelly thing.
Yeah, it's kind of like oozing. So I liked the shapes because it felt very organic. However, if we were to try to manufacture that would have some serious problems around the pelvis area. That's not going to support his upper body just in real life.
It's the kind of thing that, when a little kid is playing with it, it's the kind of thing that would break, right? Where you want to make sure these toys are durable and that people can actually enjoy playing with them both in the game and also as existing figurines.
Yeah, definitely.
And that they'll pass drop tests.
Yes. We're going to drop them from 10 feet and see what happens.
So actually, so that first version, it kind of brought us to our knees because we were like, man, we can't figure out the right design for Venom. Because, and then we tried beefing up, because we had already designed Spider-Man.
Right.
And Spider-Man's quite a bit smaller than Venom. Mm-hmm. So we made him like Captain America size, and it still didn't feel right. And then, like, I had a Marvel friend visiting from out of town, mm-hmm. and we went out to the coffee shop, and I was like, dude, I really can't figure out Venom. And he was like, well, when I think of Venom, I think of this kind of, like, monster, just, I'm going to scratch anything and bite anything at any time. But he's, like, really happy to do it. And he's, like, just running around everywhere, like, on buildings. And so we just, really quickly, we just sketched up. So I was sketching up these napkin drawings, like, at the coffee shop. It took about, like, 15 minutes or something like that. But it kind of led into the direction of, like, of Venom in the future where we ended up. So
that's cool.
Yeah. So that was a lot more substantial. So we put him on the Hulk class rig.
Okay.
And then that made him feel a lot more monstrous. And I just had to make sure to give him a lot of teeth and make him smile a lot. Because he's Venom.
He's like a crazy agent of chaos, right?
I remember coming into your office, John, when you had this up, and I lost my mind. I was like, that's it, that's it.
You did
that's
it.
So awesome. And we were almost out of town. Out of time. Yeah. And then I ran down to Jeff Bunker's office, our VP of art, and I was like, have you seen the Venom that Jeff just got on the screen? It's like the best ever. And he's like, we're out of time, JV. He's like, no, we have to do this.
John Vignacchi makes toys for gamers of all ages because John Vignacchi has the enthusiasm of a 10-year-old playing video game, which is the best.
It was the right thing to do, though. Yes. I mean, this thing turned out awesome.
No, the style is perfect, but the pose, I mean, the final pose you ended up with is amazing, yeah. But the pose also in its own right is not the easiest thing to nail, right?
So we go through a plethora of poses, and we often have to do it in order for us to figure out that's not what we want to do.
Right.
So that first pose is on the top.
Mm-hmm.
We knew we wanted to have him, like, be all...
Claw-focused?
Like, yeah. Scratch something. But when we got him into that pose, it just felt like it wasn't clear what he was doing.
Like an uppercut or a, yeah.
Smell on his arm?
Yeah, looking a little smelly. Yeah.
Flexing.
But and then we did the one on the bottom. So I sketched up something that's very close to the one on the bottom. But what I was really trying to push was that anticipation pose. It's mm-hmm. like the dun 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 that pose.
Yeah.
Because that pose.
I'm sorry. What pose is that?
Like instead of the dun dun, it's the shave and a haircut knock.
Dun 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 dun.
Is it? But not all the way.
It's the suspense in the middle.
Like, can you guys imagine what goes through this dude's head as he's doing this? I need the dun 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 pose.
How do you write that on a sheet, on a design sheet for a character? And so you have him sort of almost in his like massive taunt, right? Yeah. How do you play into this?
I just want to cut in. One of the things I love about, and especially if you compare it back to like the T poses from the slides before, how much you're saying about the character in the pose. Mm-hmm. Like one single pose, especially when it comes to us in the gameplay side, you know, there are characters I don't know so much about. And just from where they end up, it really helps us. And especially with this rig, I remember when you guys decided to go this big, I got super giddy because I could make Hulk and Spider-Man like one character almost. And actually, I think he's pretty much the most OP character in the game or something.
Yes. Actually, the latest patch rebalanced some. There are more powerful characters now in the game, but more on that later.
It's a living world.
Yes.
In a digital age. Well, that's really cool. And then you come to a character like Merida, which is a whole other... kind of challenge because she has a very particular element that makes her hard to get into this style, right?
Definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, her hair in the movie is totally unwieldy. Like, and they're so thin and just all over the place.
Well, it's part of what makes her kind of awesome looking on screen, right? Yeah.
It's great. It's almost like a new, it's just like its own character on her head. And so we had to make sure that when we sculpted it, it's a way, like, it felt sculpted in one piece, but trying to get that manufacturable, like how it pulls out of a mold, like, we had to do some serious R&D.
Why did we take the wisp off of the bow? I forget why.
Oh, because we were trying to, like one of our modelers, brilliant idea. He was like, since we have a light.
The light underneath,
and it shoots up from the bottom from the reader.
Right.
Like, if it's on the bow, eliminate there.
So I thought, okay.
All right.
That obviously makes logical sense.
Ongoing product development happening right now on stage.
I remember the wisp being on.
You're talking
on
about the little
bow.
Blue wisp that's on the bow in the concept drawing, but it's on the ground in the final.
I thought it had to do with because the weight of the wisp was going to make the bow bend, and that was part of the reason why we had done that. But
sure.
Whatever.
As the plastic gives over time, you mean?
Right.
Weigh it down.
Oh, that's a funny story too, by the way.
Oh God.
Holy jeez. so the arrow had to pass tests. Mm-hmm. And so in the beginning, the arrow is like super thin. And even there, it's still quite a bit thicker. But in the toy, it's like a missile. It has to be like that big.
Yeah.
On the bow. And nobody notices and thinks. But I'm going to say it anyway. We couldn't manufacture the string because the string would be all wobbly.
Right.
At that size. So we just omitted the string. And nobody called us on it. So yes.
She is. She's an invisible bowstring. She's just got the power of Scottish magic. So you build all these characters. You see the final kind of sculpt down into the figurine there with the pose. But you build all these characters. They're really great. You define this art style. And then you hand them off to the gameplay team to start actually making this into playable characters. And the toys to life part, like this is the to life part, right? You have to make these things come alive in the game.
Yeah,
how's that handoff work? And I guess maybe we can talk a little about making those things take place, especially the heroic gameplay that's sort of in Infinity 2.0 edition, !! Oh. Yes. Do you want to talk a little bit about the superhero gameplay? I mean, we can see some of the key art here on screen, but taking these figures and making them feel like they're alive for people who are playing them. I don't know who's taking the lead on this section.
I'll take
you have all
this.
The microphones.
So, coming into Disney Infinity 2.0 Marvel Superheroes,
nailed it.
Basically, the closest we got to doing a really melee combat centric game was the Incredibles playset in Infinity 1. Mm. And those characters kind of set the groundwork for where we would go with combat.
Sure.
We just knew, we're going to focus on melee combat more. We have these superheroes. What are the ways in which we want to grow that system? And so what we did is we added things like the block breaker combo, which is a press and hold maneuver on the attack button. Mm-hmm. We added like charges to the right trigger, which is usually your range mechanic. And we expanded out the ways characters can express their combat style. So Drax right now, He's very melee-centric. He doesn't shoot anything, but he can, charge. He can go into, like, a berserker mode. And then we also added the special ability, which is a metered ability. You see Nova's here. His is basically he levitates everyone around him and then goes supernova and damages everyone. And this is a way we could have each character express, their superheroic, nature uniquely from one another and have that big moment. Which is really cool. It's a fun thing to kind of R&D and get into gameplay.
Well, it's a pretty big gameplay evolution from 1.0 to 2.0 of really having these iconic big moments because they are superheroes and there is, a move or a thing you're expecting to see and you need to have a way to actually get that in the game.
Yeah.
And not have everything be, a Nova explosion every time you hit the X
button. Totally. I actually really like that we got, some characters had the big attack, some characters had state changes. We could have a lot of fun with how they expressed that totally. Special ability.
And of course, the big meta gameplay element is the skill tree that you added to 2.0, where you can actually upgrade the characters on different paths. What was the impetus to making there be an upgradable skill tree in this Toys to Life game?
I think we had in Infinity 1.0, we had a really good, or just Infinity, Disney Infinity. We had a really good. I know, I'm like, did I say that right?
Yeah. Oh god.
We had a really good kind of 10-minute experience with each of the characters in the game.
Sure.
I felt like, you'd put them on the base and bring them to life, and that was magical. And the things they did really represented them, but they weren't very deep. Mm. And I wanted us to get that, multi-hour experience out of each character so that when you purchase this character, you could invest in it and still be rewarded from it over, multiple hours of play.
Cool.
And so that was really the impetus.
That's awesome. And then you have
of course, that's what fans ask for.
Right.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
Like, we want deeper gameplay. We want to be playing this character for hours, not for, a fun.
I want to level this character up and have it mean something.
Totally.
And then you take that over in the crossover characters as well, where you start seeing, different Marvel superheroes interacting together in ways that maybe you wouldn't always immediately expect.
Yeah. And that was actually, I think,
world.
Fan feedback too, right, from the first game?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is that fans had wanted, no matter what, I want to have the ability to have characters from one playset go into another. And that's, like the toy box mode allows that type of play. I mean, part of it is that we wanted to, for fans that were fans of the particular property that we were representing, we wanted to make sure that we were providing an experience to them that was pure and true and what they knew. And at the same time, we also want to protect the filmmaker's vision of what their property is. But with the crossover characters, the conversation was actually really easy with Marvel.
Mm-hmm.
We had talked about it, and they're like, our characters cross over all the time.
Right.
We want this to happen, and it's something that is very distinct about Marvel. you know, as a franchise. And so it was a big part of the reason why we embraced it.
Well, and so you're talking a little bit about story, so maybe we can move over to storylines and how you come up with, see that seamless transition segue, storylines, and how you work that from the concept art all the way through the playset for people to actually work with different franchises. So, you know, going from the Avengers, authentic Marvel storylines, I don't know if you want to talk about how you translate that into Disney Infinity.
Tell us,
magic.
Brian.
Okay, Charles.
Tell us all about it.
You know, it's interesting when it comes to Marvel. I honestly didn't grow up reading comic books. I was much more of a Disney fanatic than I ever was that. So when it came to that, I basically just turned it over to two guys inside of the story team, Adam Coford and Adrian Ropp, who lived and breathed it.
Awesome.
So at that point, I just turned it over to them and say, okay, here's where we're going. Where do we go from here? So Marvel did is they hooked us up with Brian Michael Bendis. They asked us, who do you want to work with?
Yeah.
So let's just pick the greatest
aim
person.
Aim high and see what happens next. Sorry.
Exactly.
I remember having those conversations with Brian's agent and Adrian Ropp freaking out.
Yeah.
Like, fuck it, this opportunity. I swear I will do anything for you. It was awesome.
And it was a great opportunity because what they allowed us to do is they allowed us to approach Brian with some ideas, and he would just, you know, push us in, and we weren't too far off.
You guys are kind of riffing jam on the edges of it.
Gives a testament to the guys in our team. The Guardians was hard because we weren't allowed to basically see the script,
till very, very late.
Yeah. And when you're trying to create a game at the same time that's going down.
Well, that's the difference, right? Is you saw the script earlier than anyone saw the movie, but in the context of game development, it's still super late to make what you need to make.
Yeah. And the security measures were crazy.
They were insane.
Like, yeah. Safes bolted to floors with key cards scanned rooms and cameras on closed circuit.
Yeah. He's not kidding. It was crazy. So you just basically at that we're kind of riding, you know, blind.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you've got Brian who's saying, no, if you stick to this, stick to that, you're going to be in a good spot. And so that's how we pushed it along with that. So.
And when you're telling these stories and you're coming in and out of these worlds, obviously one of the ways the people are creating their own stories with the characters, and you're playing through the playset stories, but in the context of the gameplay, you also have these animations and cinematics that really do drive the foundational elements of the narrative that you guys have set up as a story team.
Right.
So, Thomas, I know when you're working with all the things that could happen in the world of Disney Infinity, how do you frame this out into telling the stories elements that set up the gameplay that's going to be happening? What are we looking at here with this really awesome sort of early?
These are just concept. Some examples. Yeah. These are just some examples of some of the storyboards. Some of them are put together and they look like pretty clean and look really, really nice. And some of them just scratches where we're just trying to get it together. But this is the type of work that we'll put together as we're trying to get the cinematics up and running and make sure that it plays right. And hopefully, you know, we're sending this out to, you know, whether it's Marvel or whether it's Pixar, making sure that they're okay with where we're going with it. So.
And how many different iterations do you think you go through for one of these cinematics?
It depends on how quickly we've got to get it done. So.
Oh, there you go. Look at that.
So that's... some of them they'll go through. I mean, I remember on some of the early stuff, we had 6 to 8 different iterations on things, but time didn't afford it on this, so we just did the best that we possibly could and just pushed it through. So.
It's really great. Yeah. So and you get to see it all the way from those like intro sketches all the way through final model and final animation.
Right in the animation.
Yeah, and the animation obviously is super important. And we talk about style, we talk about feel. It's not just how the characters are modeled, how they're rendered, but also how they move and how they move around the world.
Yeah, and with animation, I mean, as an animator, to work on a game like Infinity is a dream come true. I mean, the wide range of characters, you know, I come from feature animation. I've worked on like Emperor's New Groove, where you can draw, you may be drawing the same character for an entire year.
Right.
And I mean, not that that's a bad thing, but to have this wide range of variety of different characters, and so there's not only so many different styles, you know, Buzz Lightyear is going to move differently than, you know, say Donald Duck, but then you have this, not only this incredible privilege, but this amazing challenge where you're, you know, you get into work one day, and you're animating Donald Duck, and you're like, holy crap, I'm animating Donald Duck.
That's awesome.
Like, this is an iconic character where it's like, people are going to be looking at this, and I got to make sure this guy acts like Donald Duck, you know? There's a particular...
Buzz Lightyear's jetpack.
Yeah, especially when
with
he's strapped
Buzz Lightyear's jetpack. Like, what does that mean? What is that going to look like? You know, and so there's a very specific style that you get with Aladdin, with Donald Duck. You know, Aladdin, you know, this is a feature film. It's very well known.
Right.
Donald Duck, even greater well known. And so there's a certain style that they're going to move and act. You know, the acting choices. You know, Donald Duck is more, you know, he's like yucking it up, kind of this 1940s kind of style of acting choices, where you're not going to see that with someone like Rocket Raccoon. Any other Marvel. And so trying to stay true to these iconic characters, make them with their personality that's very distinct, mm-hmm. is a tremendous challenge. But what a great privilege to be able to do something like that and to work on these characters.
Well, and you do see almost the craftsmanship of it, right? Because you don't just have a male and a female rig and you're done. You have giant hulking characters and big human characters and skinny, nimble human characters and raccoons and giant animals and, you know, mounts. And the amount of stuff you guys have to get in the game, I don't know how you do it. It's impressive.
That's the fun part and the challenge, you know, is creating that weight. You know, when you have a great big character like Sully or Venom and the way they're going to move, and then you have a tiny character like Stitch that may be bouncing around. And so just using those animation principles that have been handed down from the nine old men to create this stuff. And so it's been just fantastic. But the challenge is there. And fortunately, we have just such a talented staff of animators that, you know, we have guys that come all the way back from feature film,
right.
Myself. We have guys that literally worked on Lion King, like old 2D guys that are now part of our staff that help us create these characters and to make them true to who they are.
Yeah, we have actually a great relationship with a bunch of the different, Disney feature animation, Pixar. We're actually able to give some of their people an opportunity to come work on games.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the time, as Thomas was mentioning, like, we'll either hire full-time people from those different groups or bring them on temporarily to work on Disney Infinity.
Oh, yeah. So I mean, we've got guys that have gone, you know, clear back to Lion King that are now full-time staff animators because they want to work on this game and to be able to work on these types of characters that we've done already that are coming up, and it's just like, this is pretty incredible to do this kind of thing.
Well, it's a really special world, and I guess that's the thing is you can tell you guys are, and you even mentioned about Marvel, like you guys are fans of the content, even if you didn't necessarily grow up with it, that you get to be a fan, you get to do things as fan service, both for you and for everyone else. So the idea of making something that is that special to everybody must be a really very powerful kind of honor to have. And you guys were able to do some really, really special stuff for PlayStation fans this year with the Marvel superhero stuff. So the PlayStation experience.
Can we go back to the Donald Duck riding the light cycle? Which is still like one of my favorite.
It's really hard to do a panel with that B-roll playing because it's like so wacky and crazy. I'm like, let's have a serious conversation about what animation rig you're making. This is Donald Duck's like zooming around and crashing into things with a rocket pack on.
I mean, Aladdin on Abu. It's just, yeah. Sorry, it still makes me smile whenever I see it.
Oh, it's just great. I mean, to come in and say, okay, here's the setup for this shot that you'll be animating today.
Right.
We've got Donald Duck, and he's going to have the Buzz Lightyear jetpack and buzzing around. And he's like, this is nuts. Like, what are we doing?
Do you look at the store team like, is there a gas leak in your office? Are you okay? You're just like saying crazy things.
No, it makes all the sense in the world.
Perfect. It's in the canon of Disney Infinity.
Right.
What's a funny nugget maybe that hit the cutting room floor? From a cinematics perspective, a story perspective.
Man, I'd have to think about it. I'd have to think.
Was that, am I melting your brain right
yes.
now?
Yes.
How many things get cut from this game? I feel like everything's in this game. It's got so much stuff.
No, there's
oh, no,
a
no,
lot.
No, no, I remember one. I remember the intro. At one point, we were going to have Hulk and Donald raging it together.
Yeah, that's
like,
right.
Like total rage fest. Like Hulk was going to go in
and
just completely destroy a machine, and then all of a sudden Donald was going to come in and say, I've got this. And he's going to finish off destroying the machine or something like that.
I want to see who can be more angry between the two of them.
So it's been great to have the game on the PlayStation platform, but PlayStation fans this year got a really unique thing. Describe sort of what we have for the Collector's Edition and this crazy statue pack almost that came together. I know it's on the desk of my boss at work, and it means that I can never put my laptop on the desk where I need to present because it's such a big, cool, crazy collector's edition. So this is your first character sketch.
So yeah, so the initial thoughts for the exclusive was like a traveling case or just something that was a little bit more convenient to house your characters. But we were just like, wouldn't it be cool if we can expand on the idea of the characters, which is kind of like reenacting a character moment. Mm-hmm. And so we wanted to expand that further.
Right? That was the big thing. We didn't want it to be junky. We wanted it to be high quality.
Yeah, this high quality exclusive. That's that cool. was relating to the boss of the video game.
Right.
And so it's just reenacting that moment. It's just like a cool place to house all your characters.
And it incorporates the characters as individual statues, but into this sort of narrative, almost narrative moment that you have. And so this is the final render out here, right?
Yep.
Oh, we went through a lot of different iterations of that, though.
When I'm looking at it, I'm like, yeah.
It's crazy. It's really, really cool.
Yeah, so like, what were some of the other concepts that we'd, like, I remember the helicarrier was one of them that we were looking at doing.
Yeah.
What were some of the other ones? The Avengers Tower.
I think you started pitching an idea for like a Hulk fist. Is that you?
That was
a giant fist.
So I was like, hey, let's do a giant Hulk fist, and then it'll open up, and you can have all your characters inside of there. And then we got into the philosophical argument of, do we want to do something that's more like a carrying case, or do we want to do something where, you know, we put so much effort into these figures themselves? Shouldn't we do a display?
Yeah.
Something that the Infinity fan and the Marvel collector would be proud to show. And so the Hulk fist, totally went away. I heard the helicarrier went away because it got way too close to an actual toy.
Right.
And so
it's a different thing.
And talking to our other partners that we have relationships with that do work on Marvel products, we had shown them our concept, and they're like, hey, that's kind of close to my territory. Yeah. So that's where this actually that pencil sketch, John, you did. Like, I think you were in China.
Yeah.
Right? Because like, this thing was coming in hot. I mean, it was like,
that's what I've heard.
Definitely on borrowed time.
Yeah.
As we were trying to do that. And you were in China, and I remember getting an email. It was like, this looks awesome. Like, this is what we should do. And then going and routing that all through for approvals against all of our different licensees that we have, but also the people of our consumer product. So.
Yeah. But this one was way super fun to work on just because, man, he's just so massive. And
it's really awesome.
I want him on my desk.
So this is a really special thing for PlayStation fans. But Johnny, you said you had something.
Yes,
I'm gonna get the John Vignacchi hype train going about
really
the other. So you're actually gonna announce something
for
the PlayStation family in general. I think Adam might.
Ladies and gentlemen, VP of Third Party Developer Relations,
Hi.
Sir Adam Boyce.
Hi, buddy.
Hey, man.
Woo.
Yes.
I thought you just called him Dragon Boys. Oh, they're gonna hug it out. Okay.
A little
chest bump. So there's a special thing you have for PlayStation fans on a new platform, huh?
So the deal... Stop, don't show them yet.
Don't... secrets.
The deal is that when Adam went over to PlayStation, we were talking about all the different things that we could do. You guys were really excited about Infinity. We were really excited about Infinity, obviously, because we're making it.
You should be excited about it because you're making it.
You lost your voice, huh?
I did.
Is that from screaming at the NeoGAF guys last night?
It's from screaming at everyone.
Right?
Always.
It's
my deal-making voice.
Right? So we had talked about supporting PlayStation Vita in a big way with Disney Infinity. So
when is that coming, by the way?
It's right now scheduled for middle of May of next year. As you know, I mean,
I just wanted to make sure that everyone else knows.
People. Yeah, exactly. But then we were talking about, what could we do to really plus that up? And in the spirit of having a great partnership between our companies, we decided to do our first ever.
Let me see
paint
a first.
Variant.
Holy crap, that's awesome.
Yeah. So this is Black Suit Spider-Man. Which will be
pretty
available
cool.
exclusively
so cool.
inside of the PlayStation Vita starter
version.
Pack
That's so cool.
out in May. So
yes.
Pretty rad.
I touched it.
Yeah.
That's so rad.
You're like the first person to hold that other than a Disney employee. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Nice.
Really
yeah, so that's the there's your PlayStation TV compatible PlayStation Vita bundle starter
and
pack.
Hats off to Diessa. This was a huge pain in the butt, right? Because of getting the painting.
Right.
It's really detailed.
We should talk about that.
So cool.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. Like,
so,
people want to know, bro.
Oh yeah, so oftentimes we're trying to figure out like how to make certain things pop, and this is you have the same spider connecting from the front to the back.
Yeah, it's a continuous.
So
Yeah, so, but then that has to be applied in two different ways, like stamps, right? So, yeah, you have to, like, align the stamps just right and then sandwich them. And then that's what you get.
Pretty cool. That's cool.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, we at one point we thought, actually, we weren't going to be able to do it. But then you guys pulled it out. So,
and the other cool thing that I was noticing about the Vita one is that, how does the bass work then with the Vita?
Well, I'm so glad you asked, Adam.
I asked my deal-making voice.
So the way that so that is actually a Bluetooth bass. So first off, the PlayStation Vita version of Disney Infinity Marvel Super Heroes 2.0 edition is
I don't think that's right,
the full-on experience. So it is not only the toy box, but it is also all the play sets. So all the play sets, if you're a PlayStation owner, and it's cross-platform as well, so if you're also an owner on the other platforms, but yep. I won't say since this is a Sony thing.
Nice. Well handled.
Okay. Thanks. Right. but so basically, you can put down your playset piece and then go in and play Guardians or Avengers or Spider-Man. So the Vita starter pack will come with the Black Suit Spider-Man, but also the Spider-Man playset. We did it in that configuration because we figured that existing owners on the PS3 or PS4 version of Infinity likely, will obviously already have the Avengers playset piece. So that's why we put Spider-Man in there, in case they hadn't been able to pick it up yet. Now they have a reason to. The base itself is Bluetooth, though, yep. So it communicates wirelessly to the PlayStation Vita. And, of course, it's also compatible with PlayStation TV. So the base will also work with PlayStation TV.
Very cool. Well, thanks for showing that off, Johnny. We really appreciate it.
Yes.
We have time for one or two questions, if anyone has questions. There's microphones here and here. We're really glad everyone came out today. Does anyone have a question they want to ask? Yes? They're stepping it up.
I'll step it up.
What you got for us?
So my question's for everybody. So when I got Infinity, my girlfriend is a huge Toy Story fan, and I went out and I got her one of the little Woody action figures. And when I gave it to her, she takes it out, and she's looking at it going like, oh, my God, look at this thing. Look how detailed. How did they do this? So my question is for everybody, was there one that you guys looked at and you held and you went, oh my God, we pulled this off? Whether it's Disney, Marvel, anything, was there one that you guys just went, whoa, I can't believe from starting here to now, we're releasing this, I can't believe we got this?
I don't know. For me as the lead designer on this whole thing, I mean, I have several favorites, but I don't know. I really like how Merida turned out. Stitch turned out amazing. Venom probably is still my favorite just because... I don't know. He looks really happy to go off and scratch something, but I'm pretty sure everybody else.
My vote was Rapunzel. Serious, I thought she turned out.
Which one?
Rapunzel.
Oh, yeah.
Mine's probably Stitch. That's the first one that comes to mind. And not just the figure. I mean, the figure is incredible, but in the game, the animation and just how much of his personality is there. It's so cool.
For me, it would have been when the first prototypes came in. And seeing Davy Jones, that was the one for me that was so eye-opening. And then we had gone to E3, and at E3, it's primarily retailers go there. It's primarily what the show's about is, here's a quick sneak peek at what's coming in the holidays. So as they're thinking about, what quantities of games they're going to order and where they're going to put support behind, at E3 you have those meetings. And so we actually showed them Disney Infinity. And when we showed them the figures, their reaction to, and our reaction, I remember being so proud of Davy Jones and what he looked like. And we had the barnacles, right, that were all coming off of him and everything. Yeah, it was really incredible. So that was the one for me.
All right. Quick question, quick answer, and then we're going to wrap up because we are over time. But go ahead.
Sorry.
Oh, I just wanted to actually ask the opposite question.
Oh.
Have you ever had have you ever looked at one and you were like, yeah, no, let's try this again?
Do you scrap ideas as you go? Is there one that didn't come out well the first time and you had to finally fix it and make it great? Off the top of your head, 10-second buzzer answer.
Yes.
Okay, great answer. Good answer.
No, but basically we catch it really early on, and then we do what's called a running change. And so we improve it right on the spot, right at the factory level, and we just kind of push it through. So
I remember Elsa's pose changed.
Oh yeah, that's right. So the Elsa that you just saw was not her final pose. Mm-hmm. So there's some problems with her as far as the thinness of her limbs, so I just wanted to make her feel hesitant but in control of her power.
Cool.
So that's kind of one of those things.
Well, thank you guys so much for coming. Thanks to everyone from Disney for the panel together. There are some posters you guys have made that I think you guys will be handing out on the way out the door, and also
sure,
you guys will be out in the hallway answering questions and hanging out afterwards. But Thanks so much for being a PlayStation experience and all the great stuff you have.
Dude,
and for
thank
Black
you for this
Spider-Man.
Opportunity.
Yeah.
We've
thank
pitched
you.
So many times doing
yeah.
a panel,
yeah.
like GDC, and everyone's like, yeah, okay, whatever. So it's really fun to be able to do this with you guys, and hopefully everyone's enjoyed watching it and being here. So thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, guys. PlayStation.